Joining us today's expert webinar. My name is Aaron Samuel from SpringPeople. SpringPeople is India's biggest corporate technology training company. As a part of our expert webinar series, we are glad to have Mr. Riaz Mulla, Head Leadership Learning and TD at Tech Mahindra. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type in the question in the question box. And at the end of the session, Mr. Riaz will answer all your questions. Now, without any further ado, over to Mr. Riaz.
So, good afternoon, everybody. Am I audible?
Yes, Mr. Riaz.
Yeah. Okay, thanks a lot. Why did I leave meeting? No, sorry. I can now hear myself. Just a minute. Hello, what has happened? Just a minute. I don't know. Am I audible now? Yeah, I accidentally pressed a long window. So let me start. So good afternoon, everybody. And while no matter how used to you get with technology, there always been a surprise or the one coming up. Okay. Is my presentation visible now to everybody? Is the presentation visible to everybody?
Yes.
Yeah, thanks a lot. So good afternoon, and let's start off with this discussion on millennials. It's a word that's been used very commonly in the industry today. Everywhere you go, you hear this challenge about how do you adjust to millennials, how millennials are slowly taking over the workplace, the kind of trends that are coming in because of the millennials. So today we'll be focusing largely on how do you engage millennials from a learning perspective. So while we talk about learning per se, it's largely about engaging the millennials, and the engagement can happen not just for learning, for other elements as well. So what we'll do is we'll spend about 35, 40 minutes or so. I'll run you through some of the slides I have got with me, and then we'll have Q&A. But not necessarily at the end of the year. If you have some questions which are there in your mind. Just are millennials, okay? Or rather, what are the generations and Gen X, millennials, Gen Z? I will just let you go through that and understand that, okay? And having done that, oh, I see some chats coming in. Just a minute. Are these any? Okay. So I'll not worry about the chats. I'll request Aaron or Shweta if they're on the year. If there's something which is not right, please come back to me. Otherwise, we'll continue the year. So having understood this, what I'm going to ask you is, I'm going to ask the participants to do a small quick quiz. Okay, just to see what is the profile of the people on this call. Okay, so I'm going to request you to go to www.menti.com. Let me put it out here in the chat window. The chat window is stop share. Hello, am I audible right? Is the audio good now?
Now it is fine, sir. Okay.
So I am going to ask you to go to the site either on your laptop or on your mobile. www.menti.com. And when you go there, let me open this for you. Okay. And I want you to put in this code 576963. So go to www.menti.com. Let me share my screen. Yes, so you can see the screen here. Go to www.menti.com and put in a code 576963 and put in your option. One person has gone there. So I'll request if all of you to please do that. There's the numbers coming up. Oh, we see a lot more millennials so far now. Oh, more coming in, more coming in. Okay, we'll wait as the numbers pile up. We have seen largely millennials. There are a few Gen X folks in the crowd as well. The Gen X's are a little slow. The numbers are rising in. So as usual, the millennials are more quick at it, but the Gen X's slowly catching up. Okay, so that sorts of if you assume that's the count currently on the session, we roughly about 60% millennials, almost. Oh, it's almost 60% millennials, 40% Gen X is there in the audience. So that's a decent mix. Okay, we're not expecting many Gen Z's there yet, and not no baby boomer as well on the year. So let's go back to a presentation, and so that. It's not been made by me. It's largely made by millennials in my team. So it's the millennials who have made this presentation. So if you find it good, then credit to them. If something is not right, then I probably did not give them the right instructions. So let's move ahead and let's look at what is the millennial mindset. Okay. So I'm going to ask you one more question there, and I'm going to go back to my screen. Okay. The Mentimeter screen, and ask one more question out here. Okay. So let's go back to our Mentimeter screen and look at one more question. Can you now go to menti.com and put this code 548273 and say what word comes to your mind when you hear the term millennial? What is the word that comes to your mind when you enter the term millennial? Let's look at what are the results that are coming in. Yeah, so those are the results coming in. Put in code 548273. Let's see what are the thoughts that are coming in. Young, independent, passionate achievers. Independent, passionate, young, coming in strong. Achievers. Agile, achievers, yeah, coming in very strongly. Passionate, independent, yes. Okay. More or less around the hardworking, dynamic, impatient, yeah, that's a new thing that's come up. Impatient, yeah. Broad-minded. Young independent folks, risk takers, tech savvy, change drivers. We got more people now, almost 43, 44. So that's interesting. But largely, yeah, young, independent, passionate, impatient achievers, dynamic risk takers. That seems to be coming in. So let's go back to the presentation. and see what is the millennial mindset. I'm also mindful of time, so I'll move a little forward here. And this is from a Deloitte study. Okay. The key theme Deloitte says that when they did this study, the key theme that defined millennials was that you only live once. Okay. And you could see what are the values that are coming in, which are stronger for millennials. We talked about passion. We talked about young enthusiasm. That's what many of you talked about. Okay. Happiness. And if you look at them, you see that these are largely inward focused values, whereas for the earlier generations, when this survey is done, it was largely the collective values that were coming in. And the key difference, if you see, is for the millennial, the focus is largely on individuality, whereas for earlier generations, it was more about family, about coming together. So many people also call the millennials as the bucket list generation. But the question that I want to ask you is, aren't these things important to most individuals today, no matter which age they are born in? Isn't happiness today being something that's being talked about a lot? Isn't diversity today, passion, of course, all of us know how much passion is being talked about. Isn't diversity on the agenda of most corporates today? Aren't we talking about something like a shared economy? Or when you talk about the Ubers and the Airbnbs, we are seeing how the shared economy and how sharing is becoming the new thing rather than ownership. What this means is that, and does it only pertain to the people born in a certain age group? In fact, this pertains to most of us, okay? And no matter which age group you are born in, I am a baby boomer, okay, born in 69. But for me, these things are today very important, okay? And one of the things which my boss says is he likes about me is the passion, okay? Which means that it's not about the age you are born in. It's the circumstances around us today, whether it is technology enablement, whether it is the instant gratification that has been today possible thanks to the technology and the tools that are available today. So expectation, no matter which generation you are in, where you are born in, is becoming same. And that is where I feel it's not about just the year of your birth which determines. It's the mindset. Millennial mindset is more prevalent today. It may be prevalent across generations also. And it is not necessarily that people born in a particular year only would have these kind of preferences which are being shown out there in the Deloitte survey. And I think that is where it's very important that we segregate the millennial mindset from the millennial in terms of purely the year you are born in. And in your workforce, you may have a lot more people who are having the millennial mindset today because that is being driven by the age that we are in, and not necessarily. Sorry, there was a year. And not necessarily the age you are born in. It depends upon the circumstances that are driving it. And that's why it's very important to keep the millennial mindset in focus and not just go by the year of birth. And I think that is one of the fundamental challenges which or one of the mistakes which we could be doing is only addressing a particular people born in a certain age or born after a certain year. But the millennial mindset, the need for instant gratification, the lack of patience is all due to the age that we are living in and may not apply to our biological ages. So let's look at how do we engage in this millennial mindset and go beyond this. So let me move to the next slide. So what does a millennial expect from life? Happiness, we looked about. A millennial is more willing. And now when we talk about millennial, remember we are talking about the millennial mindset. It's somebody who's willing to embrace uncertainties, because we essentially live in an age of change that has never been seen before, which means that there are more uncertainties than there were earlier. So this ability to embrace uncertainty, and that brings it another very interesting thing, the ability to question whatever is there today. Is this the only way? And that's one of the reasons why entrepreneurship is on the rise, is because today technology and change allows you to look at existing business processes, existing business models, and really question, is this the only way of doing things, or is there a different way? That brings in uncertainties with it. But the millennials, the interesting thing of millennials, they are willing to embrace uncertainty. They look at work-life balance. My question marks over here as well, probably they tend to focus a lot more on work. Life for them, of course, means individuality. So they are not willing to sacrifice the individuality for work. So for them, work-life balance is work that respects their individuality. And that moves us to the next thing about flexibility and freedom. If you ask the one most important trait, whether it's your learning programs, whether it's your learning policies and certifications, or any other organizational policy that you have, if it is not able to provide flexibility and choice, then your chances of engaging the millennials is going to be extremely less. Because for them, the number one priority is flexibility and the freedom to choose the way they would want. Okay. It brings in its own challenges. We'll talk about that. Because for them, eventually, as we look about happiness, core, as we looked in the previous exercise, happiness is at the core and is the number one priority for them. So anything that gives them happiness, choice, freedom, flexibility is what they are looking for. And very interestingly, for them, setting big goals and achieving them is important. We already know this is an age of instant gratification. They want bigger things in shorter duration of time. When I started my career in the late 80s, in the late 1980s, the dream was that one day I would own a 2 BHK. Today, when associates enter the workforce, they expect to have a house of their own very fast, very soon. For us, it was a lifetime goal of owning a house for ourselves. So they want bigger things, and they are not willing to wait 20 years to build that. There's no question of having a 20-year goal.
Mr. Riaz, Shweta here.
Yes, Shweta, tell me.
Yeah, so I think maybe you can keep the mic a bit away because people are saying that they are not able to hear you clearly.
Okay. Is it better now?
Yeah, I guess it's better. Okay, guys, I hope it's better now.
Holding the mic very close. I'm sorry for that.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
So for them, goals are important. Relationships are not. So if it comes between goals and relationships, we have to remember that goals are important and they want challenging, inspiring goals. That is what they are looking for. Expectations from work out there, freedom we looked at. They want guidance, but with freedoms. They want responsibilities, higher responsibilities. A lot of equality is expected, whether it is gender, whether it is seniority, and they don't want to be told. Give them a goal and let them empower them to deal with it. They don't like detailed SOPs, procedural steps, etc. So that's what they expect at work. So let's any questions here before we move into let's look at some questions here if there are before we move into the way of how do we deal with the learning part for the millennials. So I'll look at some observations here that have come in, and I'll see if I can address them as I go along. Thought million don't own ownership. when you say owning a 2 BHK is a goal I am setting in there, they expect to have either a house of their own, may not be if their own, but definitely into a place of their own. Okay. We would have expected a place of our own as a lifetime goal. That's what I meant over there, Himanshu. But that's a good point that you brought out. Isn't instant gratification a behavior, a result of unrealistic goals set by the Gen X or millennials? It could be. The question is, who are we to determine whether goals are realistic or not? The thing is, whether right or wrong, they expect to achieve more, and they expect to achieve more at a much faster rate than anybody else before them ever achieved. How to trust them? I think that's an interesting question. We'll go ahead and see there. How to trust them? We'll address that when we move forward. Okay. So let's move ahead. Let's move ahead and let me see if we can do a quick quiz here. Okay. Just let me see. So we can run a quick quiz if I can get it running. So what I'm going to ask you is one more thing. Okay. No, the Kahoot is not working in, so sorry, we'll not do that. Let's move ahead with the presentation. This is the generation. How do you engage? What are their expectations in terms of how do you engage them from learning? And then let me take you also through a case study of what we did with a special program that we ran for the millennials, which is fairly successful, giving us great results. So what is working over there? What is not working over there? Let's spend some time over there. So how do millennials prefer to learn? Number one, very clearly, largely through visualization, videos, short, crisp videos, is the way that in which they prefer. So visualization is very strong for them. Again, the duration is important, not long videos, and videos which they can run through any device, largely through their mobile handheld device. So it's a generation that's largely getting into handheld devices, very addicted to handheld devices, and not just them, most of us are getting addicted to handheld devices. So anytime, anywhere, any device is important. Challenging the status quo is important, which means that you give them theory and then ask them to practice doesn't work. Can you give them an assignment which challenges the way things are being done? Can you flip the classroom and use a flip learning methodology? So anything that challenges the status quo is something that they connect with very fast. Interactive, like we did trying to use menti.com or using Kahoot and running sessions through Kahoot or quizzes, etc. So interactive, which makes them collaborate, because remember, one of the things which is very important for them is peer learning and peer network. So they are more likely to join a course or take a session depending upon what their peer says, not depending upon what their boss says or what the experts say. They are more likely to say, oh, most of my friends are going and doing this activity or taking up this course or a course, then let me go and do it. The challenge in today's world, again, we have to realize, is in fact that not a dearth of choices, especially if you go from learning perspective. The challenge today is there are so much choices that what do you pick up? If I want to learn, say, an AI, or if I want to learn blockchain, the amount of things which are available on the net to learn something like that is huge. Now, what exactly should I go and do? That is a challenge. And that is where they trust their peer networks. And there was a question on trust. They trust their peer networks, whether we like it or not, but that is a fact that they would trust their peer networks more than they would trust any other source of information. And that is why like, shares, etc. Drive them. That's how they would want to learn, more by working with peers in a collaborative manner than here. real life challenges and examples. So a hello world kind of assignments will no longer work, don't work, and we see why they are going out of fashion now. Do me a real life challenge, real life assignment, work on it, and they would want to win. So while the need to win is very high, okay, they also get bored very easily. So experimentation is very important, okay? Trying to do many things. So it's very unlikely that you will get them doing a thing for a year or 2 years. They have something which they'll work on for a few weeks, few months, and then move on to something else. So so they like to experiment, they like to win, but at the same time, they tend to get bored also very easily. And that brings in a challenge. How do you keep the newness in a program? How do you find out new ways of engaging them? That is going to be very important. So these are some extremely important things from a learning perspective when it comes to millennials. Let's move forward in terms of engagement. And once I do this, then I will take some questions and then I'll get into the case study. So how do you engage millennials? Very easy. The social media is very, very important. Something, and when I say social media, anything that makes it social. And there are multiple sites today. We looked at just menti.com as one option. Kahoot is there, and there are so many other such sites. How can you make it social? How can you make it interactive using the sites that we talked about? How can you become more practical? Give them real life problems to solve. Shadow learning and peer learning. Both, if you want them to learn from a leader, the best is to put them along with the leader. They would not want lectures from the leader, but sit with the leader, shadow the leader, observe the leader. And that is how, in fact, inspirational leaders, they get inspired by leaders who are achievers, who perform, who demonstrate the kind of qualities they are looking at. So success for them, goal achievement for them is important. So if you put them with a leader who is an achiever, no matter what is the age of that leader, they would be very keen to learn from that. And not through sessions, but through being with the leader and seeing how the leader addresses a particular situation. So that kind of learning, either peer learning or shadowing role models, we found is a very, very interesting way of engaging them. Degrees, anyway, we see that trend of going out of fashion. It's courses which are becoming important. And courses that focus on application. So we the trend which is visible now is how degrees are going out of fashion because it's about application. They're keen to see application rather than anything else and no spoon feeding. Ask them questions. They love to be questioned since they question status quo. They are also okay to be asked questions which make them reflect, which make them go and think, okay? And if somebody questions their status quo, they would tend to appreciate that person and look up to that person as a leader more than anything else. So these are some of the ways in which we can, and of course, the last point, let me focus on that. A very strong what's in it for me. It has to be clear, it has to be strong, and it has to be in the immediate future. There is nothing like after 3 years you will be able to achieve this or after 2 years you will be able to achieve this. That will not interest them. So the what's in it for me has to be clear, has to be strong, achievement, goal-oriented, and has to be in the near future. It cannot be in the distant future. These tenets are extremely important. When you are engaging with millennials, giving them a 3-year vision, a 5-year vision may not excite them a lot. So being aware of that is extremely important. Let me look at if there are any Q&As here before I go into the case study of a program that we did here at Tech Mahindra. So any Q&As here, we got about 10 minutes more for me to do the case study. 10 to 15 minutes. So I can take a few questions now or a few observations now. Freedom they expect, but in my experience, they misuse the same too. Deepthi, that's a good point. There, and that may be because their view of freedom is different probably from our understanding of freedom. Yeah, freedom, with it comes responsibility. But since they are short-term goal-oriented, they may tend to do that. That may happen, but I wouldn't want to generalize that. In our experience, it may not be a generalized statement. What is the limit to freedom? What are the boundaries? We'll talk about that deeply when we get into the case study. So in the case study, some of these points should be addressed. But I completely agree, especially when you're talking about corporate setting, there have to be limit to the boundaries. How you define the limits are interesting. I will talk about that when we get into the case study. Or we'll talk about that after the case study. Let me see if there's anything on the chat. How to make them accept change. Okay, I'll take that again. I'll leave the questions which may probably be addressed by the case study. I'm just seeing, going through the question so that through the case study, I can bring those points out. How to make them accept change. We will look at that. Please show the previous slide for 1 second if possible. Himanshu, if you let me know which slide you're talking to, I'll put that slide on for more than a second, definitely. What are the transformation issues that can be brought in shaping millennials? We'll talk about that. To be able to meet a long-term goal or vision, we need to start today. So it will be multiple short-term goals that will help achieve a long-term goal. That could be one observation, one way of doing it. Does the millennial really look at it like that? I don't think so. So yeah, this is an important point. It leads me. For the millennial, it is the experience which is important. They believe in, for them, living the experience is more important than anything else. Okay. They may go about living the experiences and then somewhere later realize that, yes, it's good to come back home. You know, the kind of the story that we saw in movies like Swades or movies like Ye Jawani Hai Diwani. I mean, I'm taking some Bollywood examples here. But that is also representative of the culture where when they tire through this exercise, because they are living a life which is pretty hectic, pretty fast, and nature has it in its rule that speed cannot be sustained for a long time, and then you will feel the exhaustion effect of it. And you hear stories about people quitting it and going to a farm and doing a farming, and those stories are becoming more common now than they were ever earlier. And that is because at some stage they realize. So for them, the experience that they are having now is important. And they are a very experience-driven generation. And in fact, most of us, and that's why if you see, everybody is now into the business of selling experiences. Okay, products and services are also becoming about. So even if you are selling products and services, you're selling them as experiences rather than just products and services. And that is why, because that's how the world is becoming. Okay. That's how, and you may call it the millennial world. Okay. I would rather prefer to call it the millennial world rather than the millennial generation, because honestly, which year you are born has not a lot to do with it. Okay. May have some impact, but not a lot to do with it. Okay. So good points coming up. The process differs from IT and manufacture. Can you please elaborate more for the manufacturing sector? So let me share my experiences. I also work closely with the Mahindra group, M&M, which is largely into manufacturing. And the difference that I see, and thanks Shikha for bringing that out. The difference that I see when I look at it in Tech Mahindra and look at it in Mahindra and Mahindra, is that the speed is different. The need for speed is different. Okay. For us, the speed in the outside world is, the change is happening at a rapid pace. But for a technology company, whether it's IT or any technology company, you have to jump in and adapt to that speed. You don't have time. If you don't adopt, you risk being losing your existence very fast.
in manufacturing, while the speed is the same, they have some time to acclimatize and use, so that that fire is not as strong over there. Though it's catching up with Industry 4.0, RPA, automation, robotics coming in, it is catching up and it is becoming faster over there. But still, there is some window, but that gap is closing fast. And in a couple of years, it may be as bad for manufacturing as it is probably today for technology. That is how I would look at it. Just let me mute it for a minute.
Mr. Riaz, hello. Mr. Riaz, I think you've muted yourself.
Sorry, that was some background noise, so I just wanted to stop that. So I hope, Shika, that addresses your question about how it is happening in the manufacturing sector. But yeah, it is changing fast. So the industries where we see disruption happening faster, definitely technology and BFSI also, especially in the banking and financial sector, where again the disruption is very high. And the change is fast. Manufacturing is getting there slowly, but everybody will get there. Okay. How to make understand that there are no shortcuts to success, how to drive them differently. So let's look at how we did it through a case study, and then let's take more questions after that. Okay. So let's move to the case study. And before we move to the case, I'm going to show you a video. We'll look at the video and then we'll come back. So this program we call as the Achievers in the Making program. What it basically does is, we take, so in IT, if you look, there are two key things. We have got sales and we have got delivery. So sales are people who bring in the business. Delivery are the people who deliver the programs. The challenge in today's world, what we're seeing is that the sales folks have to understand some amount of delivery and technology. They can't be pure relationship guys who are just whining and dining with the customer. Today, customer expects the salesperson also to understand business application technology a little. And we found it a bit of a challenge to also bring in technology focus for the sales guys. So one thing we also wanted to try was take youngsters from delivery who had an aptitude to sell, identify them, put them through a boot camp program, and then put them into front-end sales roles, because they already come from delivery, so they understand solutioning, they understand the process better, and they understand technology better, and as a result, they can probably become better sales guys if you put them. So that was the genesis of the program. So essentially, we are taking people with 6 months to less than 4 years experience, essentially millennials, who are coming into this program, and they are being groomed to take on front-end sales role. So like they say, millennials love to enjoy, love the experience of audio visual. So let me take you through through your audio. Let me just stop sharing a minute and then play the audio for you. Just hold on. So I'm going to play this audio for you. It's a 2-3 minute audio, and then we'll discuss the program. Thank you. So this was the AIM program that we run, the Achievers in the Making program. It's basically done in a FIP classroom methodology with 8 weeks of virtual training, 4 weeks of face-to-face boot camp, which is about 60% gamified simulations, and about 20 to 30% is processes with a lot of physical exercise. So it's right from 6:30 a.m. to about 9 p.m., 10 p.m. in the night, very intensive boot camp, followed by giving them actual products and services which they can go. They have to go out and sell in the field, and then there is an MBA kind of an allocation where requisitions are there, and day 1, day 0 that happens. That's the model. Interestingly, very important to look at the results. This has been now running for 3 years with us. We have got about 170 AMRs, 120 AMRs in the system today. They have brought in business worth about 107 million TCV over the last 4 years. So that's almost four times the investment that we have done. So a very high ROI there, very successful as a program. Attrition rates are is a big challenge for us. 70% retention within the community. We have seen high pots we've been able to retain. The sales positions have been filled internally. External hiring has been reduced. That's a big cost. Okay. But key thing is the learning for the participants and our learning from the program. And that's where I will. So learning for the participants, when we did a survey of the participants, that this is what largely came out. But what are our key learnings? Okay. And the first thing is we catch them early on. They're millennials, we catch them early. And the important thing is that they carry less baggage. And that's the big advantage you have got millennials. When you try to change a person who is senior, experienced, and where most of the change initiatives fail, in the middle management, is because the person carries so much of experience, and the experience becomes a baggage and provides more reasons why something will not work rather than reasons of why something will work. A millennial is more keen to look at, oh, if this is it, if this is the challenge, what needs to be done to resolve the challenge? An experienced person starts looking at reason on why this thing doesn't work or will not work. And that is something which you should leverage. We felt leverage that. A very clear articulation of what it's wanting to plan. I think this is one of the key success factors. So the person is taken out from the current role, put into a new role, given a salary change structure which will apply immediately and which is staggered over the 2 years. So he sees, number one, a change in his or her role, going into an area of his or her liking. Number two, there is a salary structure change that is graded over 2 years. We have, and somebody asked me, how do you ensure over a period of time? We ensure that this graded salary is structured over 2 years, which means that the person is at least committed 2 years. So you have to put in some emotions. Otherwise, we have seen that loyalty is not one of their key considerations when it comes to their priorities. But yes, if you structure it over 2 years, then they are there at least for 2 years. So our attrition within the first 2 years is almost zero. Learning by doing and experiencing. Leaders, they are shadowed with the leaders. They are put along with the leaders. So they learn by inspiration more than motivation. And somebody asks them again, how do we... So if they see somebody who has achieved what they are looking for, then they are very quick to tag on to that person and learn from that person. But if that is not clear, then they will not learn from anybody whom you put in front of the class. How do you identify those achievers and tag them along with achievers? And how do you give them problems to solve? So we give them case studies, we give them CXO pitches. They get beaten up in the early stages, but they are fine with that. But they love that methodology of given an exercise which they have to do, they have to perform. Even if the performance is not good, they are willing to learn and do that. Okay. And there is a continuous input and mentoring. So engagement has, you have to have in a continuous engagement with them. You can't just leave them to the system. So that requires putting in manual effort. Okay. And the other thing which is very important is the brand. Today,
the AIM brand has become. So they are also, millennials are also attracted by brand. Brand is very important for them. The program has got such a high branding in the organization that everybody aspires to be a part of this program. And we get about 800, at least we do it twice in a year. Every time we do it, we get at least 800, minimum 800 to 1,000 applications. Our batch is only about 25. Okay. So we get anytime between 30 to 40 times the number of applications that we have. And people want to be associated. So they would ensure that they do the hard work. Post the program, they realize that if they don't perform, the brand gets impacted. It's not now you no longer an associate, you are an aimer. And if an aimer doesn't perform, then the aimer the aim brand gets impacted, and they are willing to do anything to ensure that the brand remains, the brand value remains high. So the brand building and the brand value, also it takes time. You can't build a brand over a one program. So it took us at least 2 years for us to have the brand today. It's a 4-year-old brand, very well known in the organization. But it took almost two to three programs for us to build that brand. But you'll have to stay the course to build a brand. That works wonders, let me tell you. That works wonders with the millennials. So this is what is the case study. I am open now to take more questions. So I'll first go to the chat window, see what are the chat observations, and then we can probably have questions. We still have got about 10, 11 minutes there. We have taken some, we can take more questions there. Empirically, let me look at some of the observations that have come in the chat. Okay. How to instill discipline in them? What should be done to make them sustain in the personal professional life? I think we talked about some things there. If you give them things that they want, they are willing to work hard. You don't have to do anything. But if they don't see it aligned to their goals, very difficult to push them. See, if you are able to show them goals and some short-term results, then you will be surprised at the amount of hard work they are willing to put in. And they'll go to any extent. That's my take on that, Ranjit. Himanshu says that empirically speaking, I see them tenacious about solutions only if the problem... Yeah, very true. Only if the problem is of interest to them. Okay. Not sure if it always fits well in all contexts. Yes, it may not always fit in with all contexts, and then you have to use things like mandates. So it has to be a carrot and stick approach both. Sometimes it may not, and sometimes you may have to force them. Okay. But if somewhere, if you show them, and especially, and that's where if they are through a role model who they see that the role model follows that, then they are more willing. So that is another approach that works, is give them role models. And role models they are willing to take from any generation. In fact, they like role models from a senior generation and elder generation. But if the person is a clear achiever, if the person is an achiever, is successful, they don't mind taking role models from any generation. Okay. And that is where, the other way is gamifying it. Gamification works extremely well with them. So for mandates and things which are essential, can you gamify it? Okay. In some way that becomes an essential step for them to move towards the step of their choice. So if they have to, for example, if they need a salary, the next salary hike, they achieve the goal, you put that they have to clear this security mandate for them to be eligible for that next goal. Then they will go and clear the security mandate. Compliance mandate. Otherwise, the compliance mandate will not. So how can you gamify it? So gamification is another tool which you have found works well, but you have to work, use it correctly. Otherwise, it can, everything, if you try to do that, it will not work. Why taking massive action is missing in the millennials, and how to make them take action? Massive action, they will take only if it aligns to their goals. If it is not aligned to their goals, we talked about that, then it you have to gamify it. But gamification can only be done for small steps, not be done for massive. can take some examples if you have, we can take that. Can you name a few business agencies who are good in building gamification? There are quite a few, but there are a lot of free tools available. I mean, we used one tool today, menti.com. I'll tell you another tool, which is Kahoot. There is another tool, which is Jeopardy, okay, which is again online free. And these are quick, simple, small, simple games. They like the small, simple things, which you put them, immediate scoring, immediate results. So Jeopardy online, there's online crossword. You get online games like KBC. These are stuff which is available freely. We use a lot of this free stuff, and embed them. There is another game known as Pecha Kucha, which is again free. We use that also a lot for bringing organizational awareness, because how do you make them learn things like what is your organization structure, etc., etc.? That doesn't excite them much. So we use a game called Pecha Kucha to tease them. Again, that's a free game. So there are a lot of such free games which you can use there. So Shika, I hope that gives you some. and of course, there are agencies like Nolscape, etc., which are into gamification big time and simulation. What are the LMS used in your organization as part of gamification? As I said, we use most of these tools in our organization. We currently got the sum total cloud version as the LMS. It has also got some gamification features, not very advanced gamification features, but it also has got some gamification features. Every LMS has, in today's world, is trying to build gamification into that area. But learning experience platforms, there are learning experience platforms like Edcast, there are learning experience platforms like Disperse and some of these organizations. So you can try them out also. There are many such learning experiences platforms that are coming in that have inbuilt gamification built into them. Okay. So these are the chat. Let me see what are the Q&As. There are some questions coming in over here. How Gen X is different. So I agree, whoever is the anonymous attendee, a lot of these features are applicable to Gen X. As we said at the beginning, it's not about your biological age. It's a millennial is a mindset. And that mindset can apply to person from any generation, because that mindset is driven by the socioeconomic conditions and the entire ecosystem we live in today. For example, a Gen X who would have been born 30 years later would definitely not have these traits. So it's about the environment, and that environment can influence person of any biological age. So we are talking about the millennial mindset. We are not exactly just the millennial. Okay. What are the implications of short-termism that creeping in the behavior? I think a lot of impact is there. But there is no easy answer to this. Can't be answered. If you see, right from individuals to corporates, everybody is struggling with them. Corporates today are struggling with quarterly results versus a three-year vision. Facebook today says they don't have anything beyond 2 years. Their vision is a two-year vision. They don't have anything beyond the 2 years because they don't know how the world will be 2 years later. Okay, so having a five-year plan, a 20-year plan, a 20-year vision, or even a five-year vision today is no longer, not many organizations really have that, because they don't know what the world would be 5 years later. So, there would be implications, but the implications will only know as time unfolds. I do not have a black and white answer to that. I'm sorry. the point of losing people is very true. Achieving goals at the cost of relationships is quite disturbing. How to address this issue? I think the first thing is we have to accept. You have to accept that this is how the world is going to be. Okay. While you continue to bring in the elements of relationship and why relations are important, and I'm sure what we have seen is over a period of time, they do realize that. But we have to give them the time to realize. Okay. It will be very difficult that we sort of expect them to realize to begin with. Okay, so we have to accept it, and then there a time does come when we have seen that they realize. Okay, relationships which are inspirational So they have to understand that they are very clear that they want to think, for them time is of essence. They want to spend time with people who can provide value. And if you cannot provide value in the relationship, then it is better you get out of that relationship. They're clearly looking at value. If there is value, they would stay in the relationship. They would definitely stay in the relationship. And that is the constant question we have to ask. Are we providing value? If you are not, for example, we have got a 2-year plan for the AMS. After 2 years, we are trying to see what can be brought in, but it's very difficult. And probably we are now, after 2 years, when we are seeing AMS, after 2 years, we are losing some of them, but we are trying to bring in more salary and something that we can do. We don't have a concrete answer to that. But yeah, we'll have to see how we can bring in value after 2 years to keep them engaged. Millennials have issues with longevity when it comes to the job. They move on quickly for money and growth. How to ensure that they stay longer in the organization? I think the way organizations are being structured is changing, especially. And as you say, it depends from industry to industry. Manufacturing, you still have some longevity. In technology today, probably organizations themselves want to be lean. Okay. Organizations are themselves moving towards a gig economy. Okay. Where you can work from any place and you work only for, and you get paid for what you work. So that's the generation. In fact, we didn't look at it. In fact, they say millennials is already passe. That was my last slide. Okay. That the millennials are already passe. The Gen Z is already here. And Gen Z is a very, very device addicted generation. Very clearly not interested in anything else. Okay. So if you feel millennials are a challenge, wait for 5 more years. And then probably 5 is also long, because the Gen Zs are already started to enter in. And for them, it's very clear what is now matters. Nothing beyond now matters. Okay. So that's how the world is coming to me. Okay. Could you share the AIM program flow? Last slide with the audience here. Let me share that slide here. Yeah, that's the program flow slide. Okay. Let me just go back to that slide of the program flow for a minute, since somebody requested that. I'm going to share that slide. Okay. Why is it not going back? Yeah, this is the program flow slide. Somebody asked for the program flow slide. I'll keep it here. That's the program flow slide. Let me go for the Q&A more. Four weeks, we looked at it, a lot of simulations, a lot of case studies, a lot of role plays, and of course, some theory, some process also. Organizationally, how do you address the fluidity at the workspace? I think that's a bigger question. May not be deeply possible to address in a very short time. Various ways you have to address it, both through your processes, through your policies, through your systems. You have to put all of that into play. There is no one single answer to that. I'm sorry. So probably that will be a longer answer if you can look at it later on. Does Gen X mindset people not relevant now? Oh, of course they are. Of course they are. Okay. It's always, the world is always a mix. Okay. It's never either or. And that's the biggest mindset challenge we'll have when we try to look at the world as an either or world. Okay, it's never an either or world. It's always and world, and in fact, it's an and also world. So diversity is important. There is an element of continuity that is needed. There is an element of long term vision that is needed. The Gen X mindset is also important. But if you are not able to adapt to continuous learning, then you can struggle. If you can adapt to continuous learning, it doesn't matter which you are. So Gen X mindset definitely relevant. Any mindset can be relevant. Okay, as long as you are able to integrate it with whatever is happening, and we'll always have diversity in its complete essence is essential. Okay. Does this age is of millennial mindset people? Yeah, that is how the world is. Okay. It is of the millennial mindset people. Okay. So that's where we are. I think that's all the questions I have got. And I think we are at the end of the boot program as well, just 2 minutes past. So I think I will hand. Is there anything else that has come up? Nothing else that has come up. Okay. Nothing else in the chat as well. So yes, I think important to know that the Gen Z is coming. So while we even while we talk of millennials, the Gen Z is already coming here. Okay. Thank you so much for being patient and listening to me. Thanks a lot, and over to you, Shweta and Aaron.
Thank you, sir. Thanks. Great. Thank you, everyone. We appreciate you being here, and we will share the recordings ASAP. Please visit springpeople.com for upcoming L&D webinars and tech webinars. We have a tech webinar tomorrow. You can ask your tech colleagues to join the webinar tomorrow on how to train a robot. Thank you, everyone. And thanks. We'll see you next time.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Bye.